My, it's good to be out on the road. I'm glad you here with me. Jerry Clower on the road. And I'm so glad you with me. This tour started at Jackson, Mississippi on a Sunday morning. Marcel Ledbetter had sent me word, Jerry, I want to take a trip with you. He's my dearest and closest friend, Marcel Ledbetter. He met me at the Jackson, Mississippi airport and said, Jerry, I'm going to fly to Boston, Massachusetts with you. Oh, I said, all right, Marcel, I'll be glad to have you. While we were standing there checking in on Delta Airlines, four people were standing over in the corner, somewhat squalling and crying. A man was hugging an older woman and a man and telling them goodbye. And that saddened me because I have had a few goodbyes in my time and I don't think it's fun. Then the man left with the younger woman and went over to the entrance to the snout, what goes up to the airplane. And he held this young woman and they squalled and looked at one another. And then he, with his head down, disappeared up the runway. Then the three people joined one another and started squalling. Me and Marcel are squalling. And about that time, the man stuck his head around the opening of the passageway and waved at the three people, says, see y'all Tuesday. Me and Marcel went on and boarded our airplane. We landed in Boston, Massachusetts. It was 0 degrees. But when we got into the hotel, it was 100 in there. 0 degrees outside, 100 degrees inside. I don't see how they live in them hotels up there. Oh, the hairs in my nose dried up. Marcel Ledbetter said, I ain't staying in no hotel this cotton picking hot. I said, come on up to the room and maybe we can turn the knobs off and get it cooler. We walked into the room, and the room was just as hot up there in the hotel as it was in the lobby. We turned off everything, put our undershirt over the vent up there. And I said, Marcel, let's get out of this room, and maybe it'll be cool by the time we come back. Come on down into the lobby, Marcel, and let me buy you a good supper. Maybe it'll help your attitude a little bit. We walked into this beautiful restaurant in this world-famous hotel, and there stood the maitre d' with a velvet black bow tie on, claw hammer tail coat. He said, hello, Mr. Clower, welcome. I remember when you were doing the theater in the round here last summer. Welcome back to the land of the bean and the cod. Marcel looked kind of funny. I said, Marcel, that's a fish up here. Marcel said, I want to eat me some of that cod fish. And we sat down at the table, and oh, what a delicious supper we had. Marcel eat a bait of that cod fish and a loaf of that big brown, warm bread. Oh, it was nice. And we talked to the maitre d' and thanked him for the good supper, got back up to the room, and it was still scalding hot. I said, Marcel, raise the window. And he raised the window, and we got in bed, and about that time, the syringes on them police cars commenced to squalling. And he got up and let the window down. We got back into bed and commenced to sweating. We was trying to get some sleep. It ought to be a criminal offense. Folks sent to the penitentiary to make them hotels hot as they are in the north. Man sitting up yonder in Washington, D.C. begging folks to turn the thermostat down. And you'll be surprised how much healthier it is if you ain't suffocating while you in a hotel. You'll be surprised. We got back into bed and kind of calmed down, and the light was on in the bathroom. I said, Marcel, get up and turn out the light. He got up and went in there. Now, this was a fancy hotel, but would you believe there was a cord coming down out of the ceiling? and that light is hanging on the end of that cord, and Marcel Ledbetter flipped every switch he could find, and it didn't turn the light off. I said, turn the light off. He said, I can't turn the dad blame switch if I can't find it. So Marcel come back over to the nightstand, got his pocket knife, walked back in there and took a hold to that cord, run his hand down on the top of that light and cut the cord in two. And the light went out, and so did Marcel. Woo! Flew from Los Angeles, California to Des Moines. Did a show there in the Civic Center. Then to Minneapolis, Minnesota. It's 28 degrees below zero. I slept between the mattresses. Then left Minneapolis and flew to Chicago. Chicago to Atlanta, Georgia, and then back to Yazoo City, Mississippi. I got in my Dodge pickup truck and drove down Interstate 55. Done drove to Uncle Percy Ledbetter's house. That Aunt Pet, his wife, was sitting on the front porch squalling. I said, Aunt Pet, something must be bad wrong. Said they got Versy down at the courthouse. I said, Uncle Versy Ledbetter ain't never done nothing to be tried in a courthouse in his life. Said they got him down there, Jerry. So I took off down there, and it was dinner time. I walked across the lawn, and that was the district attorney. I said, what have y'all done to Uncle Versy? Said, Jerry had a wreck and said it to wreck one thing and something else later. What do you mean? Uncle Versy ain't never lied in his life. Said, well, he's finna take the witness stand. Come on in the courtroom and watch him. Uncle Versy took the witness stand, raised his hand, and the little fancy lawyer got up and said, Mr. Ledbetter, didn't you, sir, at the scene of a wreck say there wasn't nothing wrong with you, and now you claim to have a broke leg and you want the insurance company to fix it? He said, that's right. He said, would you mind facing the jury and telling in your own words, please, why you lied then and you changing your mind now? Uncle Versy said, I wouldn't mind doing it a bit in the world. Said, I loaded up a hog, and I was taking that hog to town to the sale barn gonna sell it. And about halfway into town, one of them great big double-decker trucks loaded down with cows sideswiped me in a curve, turned over on me, knocked me down in the ravine, and them cows poured out on me, bellering and broke all to pieces. I thought I was a goner. And I'm laying down there with a broke leg and all them bellering, bleeding cows. And up walked one of them big state troopers with them black boots on. Moved his coat around a .357 Magnum and pulled that Magnum out and asked the truck driver, what's wrong with that cow right down there? Said, that cow's got a broke leg. Boom! He shot her right between the eyes. That trooper asked that truck driver, what's wrong with that cow over yonder? Got a broke leg. Boom! Shot her right between the eyes. What's wrong with that cow over yonder? Squirming and bellering, says she's got a broke leg. Boom! Shot her right through the head. Killed her graveyard dead. Said that gun is smoking. That trooper had the barrel of that thing tilted a little bit. And he looked down at me and said, sir, what's wrong with you? And I said, not a thing in the world. I was out there at Hollywood doing one of them talk shows, sitting on the couch and had my feet propped up on the coffee table, watching my turn when I was supposed to go out on television. And in walked a lady. And just as she walked in, she grabbed her Adam's apple and screamed, lacking to have scared me to death. I said, lady, what's the matter? She said, oh, look at your boots. Your boots are lizard boots. And some little creature had to be put to death Some little creature had to be killed to give you a pair of lizard boots. I said, no, ma'am. A greyhound bus run over this lizard. And I said, lady, after a greyhound bus run over this lizard and killed him, I run out there in the middle of the highway and fought the buzzards off of him. Then I made me a pair of boots. She said, well, I've heard some of your records, and I hear you brutally talking about killing a little rat. I said, lady, you ain't serious. I mean, you ain't again killing them rats. She said, you don't have to be so brutal. I said, lady, I'll tell you something. This is a true story. You listen to me. Now, I know you're a high society city woman, but it's very obvious you are educated beyond your intelligence. I said, lady, let me explain something to you. Me and my brother Sonny used to work out in the field. A rain had come and Papa would send us to the corn crib and tell us to shuck and shell corn while we couldn't work in the field. Get ready to go to mill Saturday. Get some cornmeal ground for cornbread. And it was bad enough for that old weevil dust getting up in our nose. I sure we'd be sneezing. But we'd reach to get an ear of corn and our fingers would touch some wet shucks. And we'd look and there'd be a stinking rat's nest messing up that corn crib. Me and my brother Sonny'd scoop up that stinking rat's nest and we'd get them little old slick baby rats out of that nest. And we had a big bird dog named Andy and he is standing out on the ground out there flat-footed. And we'd throw them little old slick baby rats out the door, and old Andy'd run and catch them whole in his mouth and swallow. Ah, humbucket! And that lady said, ah! And she broke and run to the dressing room and left me alone. Clovis Ledbetter, y'all remember him. He was the one that was downhearted all the time and never said a word until he was 22 years old. He didn't want to be Clovis Ledbetter. He wanted to be a log truck. And everywhere he went like he was a log truck. But after he got grown, he fell in love with a little girl and decided he'd commence to talk it. And he knew he had to get him a job, so he went to the Builder's Mart store there in Southwest Mississippi, and they recommended that he go to work for a local contractor. And Clovis Ledbetter got him a job. He said it was a construction job. He figured that it was on the inside, and he didn't wear too many clothes. He is up four stories high, helping a bricklayer lay brick. He is mixing the mortar and toting bricks to him. After about an hour, Clovis Ledbetter said, I'm freezing to death. I got to go to the house and get me some more clothes. The man said, you can't leave. You the only laborer I got. Get to work. He said, well, I'm freezing. Bricklayer said, I tell you what you do. Said, get two of them strings over there and tie the breeches legs, the bottom part of your overalls as tight as you can to your boots. And then undo the two buttons on the side of your overhaul britches. And yonder's a pile of stuff over there. Says John Manville fiberglass. And Owens Corning fiberglass. Said you go over there and just pick you out whichever one of them you want or mix them up. And ram that fiberglass down in your britches legs. Pack it down in there good. Get it all down in your stride, where it'll go good back there. And then, Clovis, undo the bib of your overhauls and take some of that pretty pink fiberglass and wrap it around your body and then put the overhauls back over it and buckle them so that you'll be warm. Clovis done that good, just like he was told. In about 10 minutes, the bricklayer said, "How you feeling?" He said, "I'm burning up." "Ah, this stuff's eating me alive." "Ah!" Clovis pulled off them overhauls and slung all that stuff out of them, turned them wrong side outwards, and slipped them back on. And just as he hit the ground, he hollered, "What can I do for this?" And that bricklayer said, "Put alcohol on it." While I was at Mr. Duval Scott's old store, a lot of fond memories were brought back to me. I don't know where this really started, but I saw it happen right after the Depression when ice trucks first started running out into the county, and if you had a few pennies, you could buy you a block of ice. Well, Mr. Duval Scott made him a wooden ice box and started selling frying-sized chicken. Why, I have carried a frying-sized chicken to Mr. Duval Scott, and I have swapped that chicken for a jar of antipane oil or a jar of vanilla extract. And then Mr. Duval Scott had picked the chicken, dress it, put it in the ice box with the little chipped-up ice down there. One day I was sitting in the store, and a lady walked in and said, "I'd like to buy a chicken." He didn't have but one in that whole refrigerator ice box deal he had made there. So he reached down in there and switched it around in that water and them few little blocks of ice and brought it out and slung the water off of it and put it on the scales that weighs 2.5 pounds. She said, "I'd want one just a little bit bigger than that." So he took that one chicken and rammed it back down in there and started stirring that ice again. Stirring it good. Come out and put it up at 3 pounds. She said, "That's fine, but I'll take both of them." You know, when I was a young'un growing up, the main most sport was marbles. Whatever happened to playing marbles? We'd draw a great big circle in the dirt and put the marbles in the center of the circle, and we'd get out on one knee and we'd come to taw. And we'd shoot that good Aggie, the taw we called it, at the marbles. And how many of them you knocked out was yours. And you could keep them if your mama didn't find it out. And I remember one time my brother Sonny, he played hooky from school. Helped him build a highway one year. And he'd help them work on them old bulldozers. And one day they was working on that bulldozer and they done found some of them steel Aggie ball bearings, and we never had seen none of them. And man, he decided he'd come to school with 5 of them. Oh, and he give me 3 of them. And when they piled all them marbles in the end of that circle and I got out there with that steel Aggie, boom, man, I done busted up the game. And we had a fella named Ben D. Lauder. He is meaner in school than Marcel Ledbetter was. He was forever more vicious, Ben D. Lauder. I was scared of him as I was a bear. Ben said, "I want you to give me one of them steel marbles." I said, "I can't do it, Ben." He commenced whooping on me and the bell rung and we run into schoolhouse. And he's sitting in that little desk. He'd been in the 8th grade 8 times. And he'd whisper, "I'm gonna beat you to death if you don't give me one of them big steel marbles." I didn't know how in the world I was gonna get away from Ben. But what I did was ease out of my desk and went back to the back of the room in the study hall like I was cold. And I took 2 of them big Aggies, them steel marbles, and put them up on top of the stove. And I got them forever more red, scalding hot. And I had me one of them brand new pair, them Red Rider gloves I had got for Christmas. Had that fringe on the side right there. Oh, had Red Rider's picture up on the top of it right there. Yeah, Santa Claus had done brought them to me. And when them steel Aggies got hot, I mean forevermore hot, I went back there with my Red Rider gloves on. And I picked them up right quick and went and put them down on that little trench up at the top of my desk where your pencil went, right there by that hole where your ink bottle is supposed to go. But we never did have no ink. And then when I laid them two hot Aggies up there, I went to the pencil sharpener like I was gonna sharpen my pencil. Miss Mentally Stone, the teacher, she had us studying. She just sitting up at her desk. Big Ben seen them Aggies on my desk. He come easing up there, you know, like he wasn't up to nothing where the teacher wouldn't get on him. And he had a right brand new pair of overalls on, and he just kind of squatted down. And that back pocket is open right there, and he took his pencil and just raked them in his back pocket. Just like nothing happened, he's back to his desk and sit down right quick. He started jumping up and down in that desk and he hung in it. He's overgrown anyhow. And Miss Mentally Stone, the teacher, run up there with this big paddle and commenced to beating him. Hush, Ben, what you screaming about? Said, boy, you got ants in your pants. Said, no, ma'am, hot steel balls. You know, where we growed up, at Route 4 Liberty, Mississippi, there's a big construction job going on one time. It's building a new high school. It's putting a tar roof on the building. And there's a lady what lived pretty close by that had 16 young'uns. She wasn't an old woman. She had one a year, just like a brood sow. Yeah. I mean, she had a bunch of young'uns. One day, she lost one of her little old children. She got to hunting him. And come to find out, he had fell in a 50-gallon drum of that melted black tar up at that schoolhouse. She reached down and got him and picked him up and shoved him back down in there. Said, boy, it'd be a lot easier to have another one than to clean you up. I said, Uncle Versa, you have asked me to go talk to Eugene Ledbetter. What is the problem? He said, Jerry, you know I'm a deep water Baptist. Eugene has done married a young Methodist girl and they believe in sprinkling. And it's hard for me to receive her into my home. And I've told Eugene I wanted her baptized proper. I said, well, Uncle Versa, I think you're wrong. I love you. But that girl's got the right to be baptized like she wants to. He said, Jerry, them Methodists will do it either way. They'll put them under, or they'll put the water on top of the head, and that girl's hard-headed. I want her baptized proper. She's my daughter-in-law. I said, well, I'll go with you to talk to Eugene. We went over to Eugene's house, and there sat that precious little Methodist girl over there holding her Bible. Scared of old man Versa Ledbetter because she hadn't been baptized proper, according to him. And Eugene said, Papa, I have talked to some folks, and I'm willing to compromise with you. If me and that Methodist preacher and my wife go down to the river and she wades out in there knee-deep, and then he, no, sir, that won't do. Said, well, Papa, what if we wade out in there hip-deep? That ain't no good. Just well stayed on the bank. Eugene said, well, Papa, what if we go out in there up to her Adam's apple? You ain't talking to me. That's sinful. Said, well, Papa, what if we let her walk out in that river till there ain't nothing sticking out of the water but just the top of her head? Will that do? He said, no, that won't do. Eugene said, I know it all the time. It's just that spot on the top of your head that counted anyhow. while I was on this tour. I was out in Hollywood, and they put me in a big limousine, and they drove me back to the airport, and I passed a bunch of folks doing some picketing. And I told the limousine driver, I said, slow down, what's this bunch of folks up to here? And I saw a big sign. It says, death is cruel and unusual punishment. We again it. I said, stop, I don't talk to one of them fellas. So they stopped that limousine and I spooled the window down. I said, what y'all doing? He said, we don't want nobody killed for messing up. And one of them big fancy ones looked like I had a bunch of them sociology degrees, got right up in my face, what had been eating onions. You're some kind of celebrity. I'm sure you're on our side, because it has been proven that the penalty for crime does not deter crime. I said, wait a minute now, you over my head. Are you telling me that the punishment for crime won't keep crime from happening? Is that what you said? He said, that's exactly what I said. I said, well, it's very obvious. Ain't none of y'all ever stole no tea cake from my mama and got caught. I said, fella, I come in on the school bus one evening, changed into my other pair of overalls and went by the safe and stole two of them big, pretty yaller tea cakes. Oh, you can eat that dough raw, too. It's plum yeller. Mama done sprinkled that sugar on them and baked them. I was walking toward the cotton field, and Mama said, Jerry, ma'am, did you steal any of them tea cakes? No, ma'am. Well, about an hour later, my mama caught me sitting on my cotton sack eating them tea cakes. And when my mama got through with me, I never, ever have ever stole another tea cake. And I don't even eat a cookie now of no kind that I don't call mama and check and see if it's all right. A lot of things happened at Route 4 Liberty, Mississippi. I remember the first banana I ever saw. I was a grown yearling boy fixing to go off to the United States Navy. Me and Marcel Ledbetter caught the train at Macomb, Mississippi, and went to Williamsburg, Virginia to Camp Perry to serve our country and go to boot camp. Some French-speaking folks, we referred to them as Cajun people, had drove up from Louisiana and brought a big bunch of bananas and swapped it to us for a coon dog. They got the bunch of bananas from the docks down at New Orleans, and they swapped that big bunch of bananas to us for a red bone hound, and it'd take the red bone hound back and run deer with him. And Mama fixed us a beautiful lunch and put two of them bananas in there for us to go off to the war. And we was gonna have that lunch when we caught that train, and Mama give us a lunch, and we got on the train and headed out to fight the war. And we's gone about 8 hours, and Mama had told us to take that yellow part off of that banana before we eat it. Marcel Ledbetter decided he'd eat his banana. He took that yellow part off and took a big bite, and just as he bit that banana, we went into a tunnel. And Marcel said, Jerry, oh, Jerry, have you ate your banana yet? I said, no. He said, well, don't. I took one bite of mine and went stone blind. Now, you got to be real country to understand what I'm about to tell you. Marcel Ledbetter didn't register for the draft, and FBI come after him. Uncle Percy said, what y'all want with Marcel? Said he didn't register for the draft. Said he ain't about to register for it. Said, well, there's a war going on and he's supposed to fight. Said, I ain't gonna make no difference. He ain't gonna fight because y'all stupid. I hear one man started all this fighting named Hitler. And why y'all just don't kill him and stop it, I'll never realize. And if there's a bunch of folks after us, it'd be different. But Hitler, they tell me, can control it, and y'all ought to go kill him. They said, well, Mr. Ledbetter, they can't get to Hitler. He said, don't lie to me. They can stand at the end of that front porch about bedtime. He's got to come out there sometime. I was at Starkville, Mississippi, at a high school game, and right about the middle of the third quarter, the official stepped off a 15-yard penalty and stopped right in front of the home team bench. The coach said, "Referee, you stink! You stink!" And the referee reached down, picked up that red rag, and walked 15 more yards away from him, said, "How do I smell from here?" Woo, I wish we'd had football when I was growing up, but we didn't have it. I never had a supervised exercise until I joined the United States Navy. We played basketball on a dirt court, took a crowbar, and let two ride it and one pull it to line off the court. If you bounce a ball on that line, not only did it go out of bounds, but it ricocheted out. And you never did have no squabbles. I remember much was said last year in the Southeastern Conference about the wrong man going to the free throw line and shooting the free pitch. Now, if it had to happen at East Fork Consolidated High School when I was a young'un growing up and the wrong fella had went to the free throw line, not only would the five players on the team had stopped him, but Cutworm Smith would have jumped out of the stands and cut him with a pocket knife. We wouldn't have put up with that. Well, I'm down at Route 4 Liberty, Mississippi. I visited everybody, and I'm getting ready to leave. Uncle Versus says, "Jerry, there's one more thing I want you to do. I want you to talk to New Gene." New Gene, you remember, was the meanest young'un what ever lived and the biggest liar I have ever known in my life. I remember there was a big collie dog in the community where I lived, and every year, the man that owned that collie dog would take a set of sheep shearers and shear that dog. Big old yeller, long-haired collie dog. And one summer he sheared that dog and just left a ring of hair around its neck and a great big bunch of hair on the end of its tail. New Gene saw the dog and come running in the house, "Lion in the yard! Oh, lion's gonna get us, lion in the yard!" Uncle Versi looked out and saw it was that dog and said, "New Gene, you go upstairs. I've told you about lying. I've done beat you and I done whooped you. And you go up there and you pray. And if you feel like the Lord has sufficiently let you know that you are forgiven, then I won't whoop you. But you go up there and pray 30 minutes about lying." A little while, New Gene come down the steps. Said, "Do you have peace in your heart that you have been forgiven for lying about that dog?" "Yes, sir." "Did the Lord make it real to you?" Said, "Yes, sir, the Lord spoke to me." Said, "The Lord told me first time he saw that dog, he thought it was a lion too." But let me tell you about my Katie Burns. She sneaked up on me and Mama. Mama was 44 years old when Katie was born. My little Katie Burns was driving with me the other day down Grand Avenue in Yazoo City, Mississippi. She is playing grown up. She is 5 years old then. She had a pair of white gloves on. She's laying on the floorboard of my new Dodge pickup truck. And she was fixing them gloves like that. And all of a sudden, she screamed, and I thought a wasp had stung her. "Oh, Daddy, Daddy, Daddy!" I said, "Darling, what is the matter?" She said, "Daddy, if I had one more finger, I could count to 11. I love y'all. Good night.